Hi, very good morning. I'm Dr. Janak Patel, MD, general physician. I'm not a cardiologist. I'm still a student. I'm learning every day. So whatever knowledge I've gathered from internet, websites, etc., I would like to share with you. Today we are going to talk regarding now the second part of congenital heart disease, that is acyanotic congenital heart disease. And whenever you use the term called acyanotic heart disease, the most common disease you come across is VSD, ASD, and PDA. And the fourth one we call as a AV canal defect, atrioventricular canal defect, or endocardial cushion defect. We'll be discussing today regarding ASD. So in an acyanotic heart disease, you can divide into two big groups: with increased pulmonary blood flow, with normal pulmonary blood flow. Increased pulmonary blood flow will be very common in ASD. In case of VSD, PDA, and atrioventricular septal defects. In ASD, you will get RVH, and in VSD, PDA, and atrioventricular septal defect, because there is increased load on the LV, you will have a LVH. In case of pulmonary anomalous venous return, there will be again more of RVH. And there will be increased pulmonary blood flow. It can be a cyanotic heart disease group. But by and large, ASD, VSD, PDA, and atrioventricular septal defect become the most common causes as far as a cyanotic congenital heart disease is concerned. In a case of a normal pulmonary blood flow, or there may be little decrease in pulmonary blood flow, the common conditions which will produce RVH is pulmonary stenosis and mitral stenosis. And which produces LVH are aortic stenosis and coarctation of aorta. Here there is no right to left shunt, hence there is no cyanosis. Same way in ASD, VSD, PDA, and atrioventricular septal defect, you've got left to right shunt. And also in case of a ASD, because there is more load on right side, you get RA and RV. But in case of VSD, PDA, and atrioventricular septal defect, you will have a more load because of increased pulmonary blood flow on LA and LV. And that will give rise to more of LVH rather than RVH. So these are the four common conditions which we'll be discussing one after other, that is ASD, VSD, PDA, and atrioventricular septal defects. This belongs to what we call as a left to right shunt, meaning oxygenated blood is coming to deoxysites, and those congenital heart disease will not have cyanosis. That's why they are put into a big group we call as a acyanotic congenital heart disease. So we are going to discuss today regarding ASD. If you understand ASD, then all other acyanotic heart diseases are also very clear. ASD is an abnormal communication between two atrium, which persists after birth. Then we call that as atrial septal defect. And this can be classified into three groups: ostium secundum defects, ostium primum defect, endocardial cushion defect. And depend upon the severity, mild, moderate, and severe. By and large, there is a single opening. There can be multiple opening, in an atrial septum, or there can be multiple small opening called fenestra. So these are the three ways you can classify ASD. The common word utilized is ostium primum, ostium secundum, and endocardial cushion defect. And depending upon the size wise, the person will have a mild, moderate, and severe variety. Depending upon the number, single, multiple, or fenestra variety. And ASD will account for almost 10% of all congenital heart disease. So there is a, because the left atrial pressure is more, the blood will flow from left atrium into RA. And that's why this is also called as left to right shunt. So these are the different types of defects what you come across. This is ostium primum. This is ostium secundum, which is in the center part. Or you have got a sinus venosus defect, which will be in the top part close to superior vena cava. This will mean the middle part, while ostium primum defect will be very frequently close to what we call as the atrioventricular groove, that is close to what tricuspid valve, or we call endocardial cushion. Or sometime you can have a very big single defect where there is hardly any atrial septum, we call as a common atrium, where the RA and LA is almost common. There is hardly any atrial septum, interatrial septum. Depending upon the size, a small defect in younger children, less than 3 millimeter, moderate variety between 3 to 8, and more than 8 is called as a large defect. So this will be called mild, moderate, and severe, size-wise. While in older children, this is double up. So less than 6 is considered as a small defect. Between 6 to 12 is considered as a moderate. And more than 12 millimeter is considered as a large defect. As the child grows, the size changes. Depending upon the location wise, ostium secundum defect, this is a defect resulting from a deficient or a fenestrate fossa ovalis. And usually it is in the center part of the interatrial septum. So that is ostium secundum. And it is the most common variety of an atrial septal defect. Usually it is a single defect and it is accounting for 90% of ASD variety. Usually isolated, atrial aperture may be single, very rarely it is multiple, or may be fenestrate variety. It may be associated with mitral valve defects or AV canal defects, not very common. Ostium primum defect is 5% of ASD. It occurs in lower part of atrial septum adjacent to the AV valve. And this particular defect will be very frequently associated with endocardial tissue formation. So it may be associated with endocardial cushion defect. And there may be abnormal mitral valve or partial AV septal defect. And there is a third variety we call as a sinus venosus variety, which is close to the superior vena cava. Or it is also called as a venous defect. I'll show you that particular this sinus venosus defect close to superior vena cava. This is sinus venosus defect. This is secundum. This is primum. A big defect and very close to atrioventricular valve. So along with this, you get the defect in formation of a tricuspid and mitral valve. So you can have an abnormal mitral valve. So in ostium, usually in ostium secundum, you don't come across mitral valve or AV canal defect. It is more common with ostium primum. While sinus venosus is 5% of ASD, it is located in the upper part, close to the superior vena cava. And it is very commonly associated with anomalous of right pulmonary vein, and that particular pulmonary vein will be opening into superior vena cava or into right atrium. That is a very common defect which can be associated with sinus venosus atrial septal defect. Ostium secundum can be associated with pulmonary stenosis, mitral valve prolapse, or partial anomalous pulmonary venous drainage. Primary defect, or we call ostium primum, very frequently associated with mitral valve or may be associated with subaortic stenosis. Sinus venosus, we already told you, partial anomalous pulmonary venous return, which is from right pulmonary vein into superior vena cava or into right atrium. There is another variety they call as a coronary sinus septal defect, where you can have a partial or total anomalous pulmonary venous return. And there is a persistence of a ref superior venous drainage. The commonest cause of ASD is because of Down syndrome. So it is very commonly associated with trisomy 18, Down syndrome. Another common condition which produces ASD is hypoxia, rubella syndrome, radiation when the female during pregnancy is exposed to multiple radiation, either because of X-rays or because of radiotherapy, etc. There is one condition which, if ASD is associated with mitral stenosis, it is called Luttenbacher syndrome. If ASD is associated with TOF, tetralogy of Fallot, it is called pentology. And there is another congenital defect where you have got a defect in radius bone along with other congenital defects. It is called Holt-Oram syndrome. So, trisomy 21, sorry, it was not 18, it is trisomy 21 is called Down syndrome. Trisomy 18 is called Edwards syndrome. And trisomy 13 is called Petiot syndrome. Holt-Oram syndrome, there will be the thumb with extra phalange, deformity of radius and ulna. That is classical Holt-Oram syndrome. There is an absent radius. In case of a TAR syndrome, that is called thrombocytopenia with absent radius, that is called TAR, TAR syndrome. And if mother during pregnancy gets rubella, it is called congenital rubella syndrome, or mother is on a teratogenic drugs like phenytoin sodium, can develop congenital heart disease. So these are some of the congenital conditions which can be there. This is classical what we call as Holt-Oram syndrome, where you will have a deformities in upper limb. 60% of the cases will have a ASD. In Noonan syndrome, Down syndromes, 42%. And this particular Down syndrome will have very commonly ostium primum or ostium secundum defect. You can have a Bertchiari associated with ASD. You can have another group of syndrome called as a Jerchko-Levine syndrome. Jerchko-Levine syndrome. So these are some of the conditions where you can have Holt-Oram syndrome. In 60% of the cases, we'll have a ASD. And this is typical Holt-Oram syndrome. You can see there is an abnormal radius and ulna, and there will be an extra phalange. Very, very classical. Now, if we go through a pathophysiology, very simple to explain. As there is a defect in atrial septum, right atrium and left atrium is communicating. During atrial systole, left atrial pressure is more than right atrial pressure. Hence, blood from left atrium will easily flow into right atrium. So, right atrium will get a volume overload, which is because of return from superior vena cava, inferior vena cava, plus there is a lot of blood which is coming from LA. So right atrium will undergo enlargement. So dilatation plus hypertrophy. All those blood from RA will go to RV. So right ventricle also gets a volume overload. So right ventricle will also undergo hypertrophy with dilatation. all that blood will be ejected into pulmonary circulation. Now, because of there is an increased blood flow there on an X-ray and pulmonary arterial circulation wise, there will be increased pulmonary blood flow. So we call it a pulmonary congestion will be there. So there will be increased blood flow in a pulmonary circulation, which leads to congestion. Secondary, due to congestion, there is decreased immunity. There is increased chance of repeated respiratory tract infection. Secondary to increased chance of repeated respiratory tract infection. Person develops infection, healing process, it ends with fibrosis. And as the fibrosis sets in, there is a gradual increase in pulmonary pressure. So pulmonary arterial pressure increases. As the pulmonary arterial pressure increases, pulmonary pressure is elevated. It will have an afterload on RV. And because of increased pulmonary vascular resistance, right ventricle will find an afterload. Right ventricle will undergo hypertrophy. It will try to compensate. A stage will come where the right ventricular pressure will become more. Now, right atrial pressure is also elevated. And as the right atrial pressure is elevated, a stage will come where right atrial pressure will be equal to left atrial pressure. Now, once that things happen, now the flow from LA will stop. This condition we'll call as Eisenmenger stage or Eisenmenger syndrome. Now, blood will not flow from LA to RA. Now, because the fibrotic process is continuous process, right ventricular pressure will be further elevated because of further increase in pulmonary arterial pressure. That will elevate RV pressure. RV pressure will elevate RA pressure. Now, RA pressure becomes more than LA pressure. Now, the flow will be from RA to LA. That is, deoxy blood will enter into left side. So, initially, it was left to right shunt. Shunt has stopped. Now it has become right to left shunt. Now this we call as Eisenmenger with reversal of the shunt. So now the person becomes right to left shunt. So person will start developing cyanosis, hypoxia, and there will be a high chance of development of a paradoxical embolization from right side into systemic circulation. And this stage is called as Eisenmenger syndrome or Eisenmenger complex, where person will now start developing symptom signs of cyanosis plus hypoxic symptoms and congestive cardiac failure. If you go through the incidence wise, female are more prone, the ratio is almost 1:2. It is the most common congenital heart disease, accounting for 10% of the cases of congenital heart disease. I've already explained you this particular part, that the blood from LA comes to RA and then to RV. So mixed blood, that is oxy plus deoxy blood, is going to lung, but it is in a large quantity. So the person will develop pulmonary congestion, repeated respiratory tract infection, etc. You can see that the left atrial pressure is 8, while right atrial pressure is 5. So the pressure is more on LA, so blood will flow from left to right. Because of atrial septal defect, you can see here the blood is coming to RA from superior vena cava, inferior vena cava, goes to lung, from RA to RV to lung, then oxygenated blood will come to LA, from LA to LV, and then to the body. Now, because of the defect from LA to RA, because the pressure here is low, so more blood will come to RA, right atrium will undergo dilatation plus hypertrophy. More blood will come to RV, so it will undergo dilatation plus hypertrophy. More blood will go to the lungs, that blood will come to the LA. So pulmonary vein will be little dilated because there is more blood which is coming. And there will be also little enlargement of LA also. But majority of the blood from LA is going into RA. Now, because of a pulmonary hypertension, RV pressure will be elevated. And that will lead to double flow pulmonary congestion, increased pulmonary venous return, and that increased pulmonary venous return will go to pulmonary vein into LA, and via ASD more blood will flow to RA. This will continue. But as more blood is going, LV input is less, there will be decreased cardiac output. So in spite of LA receiving more blood, still blood going to LV will be less, and there will be decreased cardiac output. So because of increased burden on the right side of the heart, pulmonary congestion, repeated respiratory tract infections, now person will start developing pulmonary hypertension, and there will be right ventricular hypertrophy, right atrial pressure elevation, right ventricular pressure elevation will be there. Secondary to that, right atrial pressure is elevated. A stage will come where the right atrial pressure will become equal to left atrial pressure. Shunt will stop, and then further elevation, now shunt will reverse. We'll call that as Eisenmenger. And now person will start developing deoxy blood from right side is entering into left side. Person will start developing cyanosis. So along with cyanosis, there is a symptom signs of congestive heart failure. And this we call as Eisenmenger syndrome. So hypoxia, CCF, polycythemia will be together, plus cyanosis, central cyanosis. So Eisenmenger will be reversal with congestive cardiac failure. Now because of dilatation of right atrium, if right atrium is dilated, you'll have a very high chance of development of atrial flutter fibrillation, which will end up with formation of a thrombus in atrial appendage. From there you can get thromboembolism. Usually in an early stage, there will be thromboembolism going to the pulmonary circulation. But once the Eisenmenger develops, there is a chance of, we call it the paradoxical embolization. So from a right atrium, it can enter because now there is a reversal of the shunt. So thrombus will dislodge. It will form an embolus. And that embolus from right atrium can easily enter into left atrium and systemic circulation, producing systemic embolization. You will have a high chance of development of infective endocarditis, and that can also end up with what we call as a systemic embolization, or we use the word paradoxical embolization. And one of the common manifestation is meningitis and brain abscess. A very small defect, less blood will be going from LA to RA. So by and large they are asymptomatic. But in a presence of moderate to severe defects, because of increased pulmonary vascular congestion, there is a repeated respiratory tract infections. So person will have a repeated respiratory tract infection, symptoms and signs. Sooner they will develop pulmonary hypertension. Secondary to pulmonary hypertension, person will have a RVH, which will produce palpitation because of big right atrium, atrial flutter fibrillation, thrombus formation, thromboembolism, pulmonary artery thrombosis. Because of repeated respiratory tract infection, decreased appetite, decreased intake of food, person will have a retarded growth. Sooner he will go into Eisenmenger, and once he develops Eisenmenger, there is a reversal of the shunt producing cyanosis plus symptom signs of congestive heart failure. He will have a very high chance of development of the infective endocarditis, and that can also produce paradoxical embolization. And this also can go into paradoxical embolization. Cardiovascular system examination will show you big right atrium, right ventricular dilatation plus hypertrophy. Might have a little amount of left atrial enlargement. And in presence of Eisenmenger, we have already told you the person will have a cyanosis plus congestive cardiac failure. Sorry, you correct this spelling. It will be E, Eisenmenger. This should be corrected. Sorry. So usually small ASD are asymptomatic. while large ASD will come to you with breathlessness, that is SOB on exertion. Once a person starts developing a right ventricular pressure elevation, right atrial pressure elevation, exercise intolerance, feeding difficulty, failure to thrive, frequent or we call repeated respiratory tract infection, forehead sweating, chest pain, palpitation, syncopal episodes, and when there is a large defect, invariably they come to you with an easy fatigability, platypnea, orthopnea, etc. So this will be the presentation in presence of small ASD and a large ASD. I've already described everything. At your leisure time, you can go through these slides. So in an early stage, in a small asymptomatic, in a medium to large stage, shortness of breath, tiredness, recurrent respiratory tract infection, wheeze, right ventricular failure, cardiac arrhythmia because of the right atrial dilatation, split second sound, ejection systolic murmur because of a large quantity of blood which is flowing through pulmonary valve. So that produces what we call the flow murmur or functional murmur. It may be associated with partial atrioventricular septal defect. In that case, you will have a pansystolic murmur on the left parasternal region. Chest X-ray will show you cardiomegaly, mainly RARV. Increased pulmonary vascular congestion. So increased pulmonary vascularity. ECG will show you right axis deviation, RVH, P pulmonal. Also, there may be what we call as a person can have a right bundle branch block, or sometime it can be associated with WPW syndromes, etc. Echocardiography will show you the size of ASD, type of ASD, then number of ASD defects or number of communications, etc. It will also help to identify the pulmonary pressure, right atrial pressure, right ventricular pressure, right ventricular size, end diastolic pressure, left atrial size, left atrial pressure, etc. can be easily diagnosed by doing a good echo. So these are some of the pictures showing you repeated respiratory tract infections. Person will have a cyanosis once there is a reversal of the shunt. Big RA, RV. So there will be cardiomegaly showing you RA and RV. We already told you that because of RV, you will have a parasternal heave. P2 will be loud, split P2. There will be right parasternal heave. Percussion wise, there will be cardiomegaly because of RVH and RAE. Pulmonary hypertension will show you in a pulmonary area, there will be a dullness because of dilated pulmonary artery and pulmonary hypertension. P2 will be split and loud. There will be systolic murmur on the pulmonary area. Mid-diastolic murmur will be heard on left sternal border. And those are called as a flow murmur, which you will be getting. So there will be pulmonary flow murmur, which will be ejection systolic, crescendo, decrescendo, low pitch, usually grade 3 to 4. And there will be diastolic murmur at tricuspid valve, which is because of increased blood flow at tricuspid. Also, there will be murmur which can be heard even sometime, even at the mitral area. And that is also a flow murmur. So these are some of the things which you will be able to auscultate. We have already mentioned chest X-ray will show you increased RA, RV and increased pulmonary artery vascularity, increased pulmonary blood flow. ECG will show you RVH, RAE, WPW, sometime atrial flutter fibrillation will be quite common. Paroxysmal atrial tachycardia can be seen. By and large, there will be a right axis deviation. In some of the condition, you can get an extreme left axis deviation, particularly in ostium primum defect. While in ostium secundum, it will be RAD. ECHO will show you RVH, RAE, valvular anatomy. You can see flow direction, number of defects, size of defects, severity of defects. Infective endocarditis can be diagnosed. You can see the direction of a blood flow. In Eisenmenger, it will be right to left. Thrombus formation you can make out in a right atrium. While doing a right heart catheterization, it will give you an idea regarding a pulmonary arterial pressure, RV pressure, end diastolic pressure, right atrial pressure, etc. You can identify. And then you can go for what we call as a catheter closure or surgical closure. So these are all X-ray chest, ECG. I have already mentioned that you will get in secundum right axis deviation, while in case of primum defect, you will have more of left axis deviation. You can see. Chest X-ray will show you more of RA and RV. So you will have a cardiomegaly showing or RA and RV. There will be increased pulmonary vasculature. ECG will usually show a right axis deviation, RVH, and by and large RS, RDS pattern in B1 and AVR. And you might have a right atrial enlargement findings. So this will be typical what you can see in an ECG. Right axis deviation, RVH, incomplete right bundle branch block. Echocardiography will demonstrate number, size, type, etc. and direction of blood flow, whether there is Eisenmenger or not. Thrombus can be detected. Infective endocarditis you can find out. So ultrasonography will be very helpful. Pressure studies, if you want to do, you will have to go for right heart catheterization and try to estimate the pulmonary pressure, right ventricular pressure, right atrial pressure, etc. For differential diagnosis, you will have to differentiate VSD, PDA, and other congenital heart disease. Management-wise, symptomatic management for congestive cardiac failure, for pulmonary hypertension, repeated respiratory tract infection. If child has got atrial flutter fibrillation, treat atrial flutter fibrillation and prevent thromboembolism. Treatment for thromboembolism or prevention of thromboembolism can be done. Even prevention of infective endocarditis can be done. And if a child develops infective endocarditis, you can treat infective endocarditis. By and large, you require drugs for atrial flutter fibrillation. Then increase the strength of, we call inotropic drugs to treat congestive cardiac failure. Decrease intake of fluid to reduce preload on right ventricle. To decrease thromboembolism phenomena, anticoagulation. Treat the repeated respiratory tract infection because it is the prime cause of pulmonary hypertension. And then goes for what we call as a repair, which can be open repair, very rarely done nowadays, unless there is a contraindication for catheter closure. By and large, now catheter closure is being done. So in a catheter closure, you introduce the catheter into RA, from RA into LV. The two plates will open up, one plate on the left side of the septum and another plate will open up on the right side of the septum, and it will close the foramen oval. The most common defect is septum secundum defects. So that is the best way. Medical, we have told you, exercise restriction, treatment of congestive cardiac failure, diuretic, inotropic drugs, etc. will be useful. Treatment of atrial flutter fibrillation, thromboembolism, infective endocarditis will be what we call as a pharmacological treatment. In some of the conditions, you can go for cardiopulmonary bypass. You can go for an open surgery where you do a purse strings closure, or you use a Decron patch. We'll show you some of those. So usually, by and large, it is done a catheter closure. So catheter closure is the most common which is done. Contraindication is very rare, particularly in a sinus venosus defect or coronary sinus defect or septum primum defect, because they are associated with other many defects. So in that condition, best way of closer by catheter is very good results in case of septum secondum defects. So this is the way you close it. You can see that one plate opens on the left atrial side and second plate will open on the right atrial side, and you try to close that. So this will be on the left atrial side and this will be on the right atrial side, and you remove the catheter, that plate will remain there, and it is OPD procedure. It is considered as OPD procedures. Very simple way to close. So these are the different devices which are available, different shapes. These are non-surgical closers, or we call disc, which are available. And in a surgical closer, you can use a Dacron material and suture, but this will require an open surgery. So this is that particular repair. You put a patch and suture it with a interatrial septum. You can go for robotic repair also. Complication wise, most common Eisenmenger, that is reversal of the shunt, congestive cardiac failure. Once there is a reversal, there will be paradoxical embolization, chance will be higher. Infective endocarditis, and then that can also end up with a paradoxical embolization. Repeated respiratory tract infection will result into retarded growth, failure to thrive. A big enlargement of the right atrium will lead to atrial flutter fibrillation. There will be very high chance of paroxysmal atrial tachycardia. Also, there is a chance of what we call as atrial flutter fibrillation producing thrombus formation and thromboembolism. And you can have associated tricuspid regurgitation also because of right ventricular failure. And in case of ostium primum defect, you can have a mitral valve defect, endocardial cushion defects. All those can be present. So these are some of the complications which can be there. Right heart failure, cardiac arrhythmias because of a right atrial enlargement, paradoxical embolization leading to strokes, brain abscess in case of infective endocarditis with paradoxical embolization, pulmonary hypertension, etc. I end my lecture here. I hope this will be helpful, and I hope this is simplified form where I can explain you regarding a atrial septum. See you in your next lecture.